SpaceX just had its first commercial launch with its Falcon Heavy and landed all three of its reusable rockets. But there's no rest for SpaceX, and it's now launching another mission, sending up numerous science experiments, including one by high school students aiming to study DNA repair in microgravity. They're also sending up tissue chips, a science fiction-sounding technology, which you may remember from our conversation with expert Dr. Liz Warren, who spoke about this during our Cal Academy night. SpaceX CRS-17 will be utilizing its Falcon 9 rocket, which can both deliver cargo and land safely back down on Earth. But landing them is not easy. It's a meticulous step-by-step process. The booster is essentially a large autonomous robot whose onboard internal computers successfully land the rocket. The booster can either land on the ground or at sea on the company's drone ship, Of Course I Still Love You. An interesting name for a ship, but also a nod to a famous science fiction novel, The Player of Games. Now, they make it look easy, but it took many, many failures before SpaceX managed to successfully land its first rocket back in December 2015. Since then, SpaceX has made multiple successful landings. I bet you want to know how it all works. Well, after the rocket reaches an altitude of roughly 80 kilometers, the first and second stage separate, the latter continuing on its way to deliver the payload. In order to reorient itself, the first stage turns on its cold engine thrusters in preparation for its re-entry burn. Following this, its three engines propel the booster towards the landing site, allowing for a controlled descent. Small heat-resistant wings called grid fins are deployed to help guide the rocket as it continues its descent. From here, the engine's landing burn begins, slowing it down. And finally, the booster's landing legs unfold for a successful touchdown. These landings are one of the reasons that SpaceX launches are so exciting to watch. But we can't forget about all of the innovative science payloads delivered to the ISS U.S. National Laboratory. What's great about the ISS is that at its heart, it's an international collaboration of science where anyone can submit an experiment. Like these students from Minnesota who won the 2018 Genes in Space contest, where students from grades 7 to 12 compete to have their proposed DNA experiment conducted on the ISS. Last year's winning team was David Lee, Michelle Sung, Aarti Vijayakumar, and Rebecca Lee. We got in touch with Aarti to walk us through their project.
So our proposal was based off our interest in the increased risk of cancer that astronauts face in space because of the space radiation that can damage their DNA even when they're on the International Space Station.
So the team worked to find a way to study how cells repair their DNA in microgravity and submitted their proposal for the contest.
So what we're doing is we have yeast cells that we will use CRISPR-Cas9 to induce a break-in to simulate that space radiation, and then we'll allow the cells some time to repair themselves. And then we amplify their DNA on the mini PCR and sequence it using the MinION sequencing tool. And based on the resulting sequence, we can see if they repaired their DNA correctly or not.
So basically, they'll be creating duplicates of the repaired DNA using a mini PCR. As for analyzing the data, they'll be using a MinION sequencer, which provides real-time analysis by taking the DNA strands and using an electric current to determine the order of bases within each DNA strand. The students will then take this information and determine whether the DNA sequence was changed due to damage and if the cells were then able to repair the DNA correctly. After becoming finalists, the team spent months working with members from MIT to build their proof of concept for the final judging panel. That meant bringing their proposal to life by replicating the realistic timeframe that the astronauts would have on board the ISS, as well as using readily available materials.
Until the conference, we had just not necessarily been restricted that way. And we didn't have to think about, you know, how much of this chemical can you take onto the ISS? Can you control the heat conditions for these cells? Things like that. So that was a really good experience for us.
The results will hopefully provide more insight into whether or not astronaut DNA repairs itself the same way in space as it does on Earth.
Until we got chosen to send it up, it became a little bit more real, but now it's tangible. It's in the near future and we're really gonna see it launch. And it feels really good that something that we could come up with and work with so many cool people on can actually benefit astronauts and benefit other people in the future.
But it's not just about astronaut DNA. There are also four experiments being sent to the ISS US National Laboratory by NCATS and the National Institutes of Health that aim to gain a better understanding of how the human body and organs function with the ultimate goal of improving human health on Earth. Tissue chips, also known as organs on chips, are small devices that contain human cells grown on an artificial scaffold to model the structure and function of human tissues and organs. These tissue chip models provide an efficient way to study the mechanisms behind disease and test potential new treatments. One tissue chip study is investigating how microgravity and other factors affect kidney function, since kidney problems occur more frequently in astronauts. Another study is using tissue chips to model the lungs and bone marrow to analyze how the immune system responds to infection in microgravity. A third study is examining the impact of spaceflight on musculoskeletal disease biology using a tissue chip joint model with cartilage and bone tissues. The last tissue chip study is focused on the blood-brain barrier and aims to shed light on the mechanisms behind neurological disorders like Alzheimer's. While those are the experiments focusing on human health, others like NASA JPL's Orbiting Carbon Observatory 3 will concentrate on tracking the distribution of carbon dioxide on Earth by collecting measurements on specific types of atmospheric CO2. This will give scientists more insight into carbon sources and storage sinks, which could help in predicting the impact of growing atmospheric heat retention, as well as controlling its variability. The OCO3 will be robotically installed on the Japanese Experiment Module Exposed Facility. Whether they be small or large, all these investigations help to highlight the incredible partnerships ongoing in space to keep pushing the boundaries of what we know of life in microgravity. There are plenty of upcoming launches, so if there's a specific one you'd like us to cover, let us know down in the comments. Make sure to subscribe to Seeker, and thanks for watching.